First of all, I think just introducing the topic, today we're going to be talking about migration consideration for SharePoint Online. Part of what we'll be talking about today is also considering on-premise as well as in the cloud. And we're going to be talking about overall strategy and a couple of interesting topics, but we definitely want to keep it interactive, so it's kind of a business meets very technical sort of conversation, and I think it's very important from an IT perspective to really understand the business as you go through this process. But first, just introducing ourselves, I am a propeller head. I do a lot of speaking around the world, different locations. Love being at these types of conferences and really get a lot out of them. I hope you guys are enjoying it as well. I work for a company called AvPoint. I'm a senior vice president, and I run some of our global business development initiatives, and I'm based out of the United States. One of my biggest hobbies in life is I love to play golf. If I'm not working, you'll find me somewhere. There's a picture of me on the 18th tee at Pebble Beach in Northern California. And in my previous life, I was a rock star. It's a true story. Do not Google it. It's very dangerous.
You can tell by the hair, if anyone, you know.
Some of my details, my Twitter handle, email address, if you've got any questions afterwards, please feel free to reach out. This is where I live. Very interesting for me. I've been there for 3 years, Silicon Valley, Northern California. Can throw a stone on the roof of Intel, global headquarters, HP's around the corner, Apple, etc. It's all happening right there. Awesome place to be. You can see that's where my office is. Spend a lot of time, and there's a couple of golf courses you can pick up in the picture there as well.
And I'm Lane Van Bergen from OBS down in Melbourne. I'm one of the architects in the pre-sales team there. And I'm a Microsoft Certified Master and SharePoint MVP as well. When and if I ever get any spare time, I like to spend it playing a bit of Xbox, but that doesn't happen too often.
And your favorite game?
Splinter Cell. Splinter Cell is definitely the favorite one. I've got some games waiting for me at home. And my contact details are up there as well. Feel free to send me an email or catch me on Twitter or grab me around the conference.
Cool. So this is kind of the high-level view of what we're going to be discussing today. Essentially, what we want to equip you for is building a roadmap for success from a migration perspective. And there are a lot of considerations. You know, you might think, oh, how difficult can it be? I'm going to move my content from my SharePoint 2010 environment into 2013. And we're going to do that. We're going to move all the information across, and it's going to be done. It's going to be great. There's a lot of things we want you to think about from an IT perspective, which encompass not just IT and specifically doing migration, but what are some of the considerations you're going to make during that process and the roadmap to follow in order to make sure you're successful. So the first thing we'll look at is determining a business case. Second is information assessment, so understanding what content you have. I'll talk more about that. Designing a new architecture once you've been through that process, pre-migration considerations, and then the final stage is actually performing the migration and actually completing and successfully. So the first area is from a determining a business case perspective. The first question we want to ask is why. Next thing I'm going to talk about is why SharePoint 2013. We'll cover that. Office 365 and the benefits. Office 365 and the concerns, which there are a couple. And also want to help you understand hybrid environments and what those really mean. So the first thing is a business case. We really want you guys to think about when you're doing a migration, this is really your opportunity to revisit your strategy. Migration opportunity, and obviously the strategy behind Office 365 and the release cycles are changing, but from an on-premise perspective, you now have an opportunity to revisit your approach to information management in your business, to try and understand, number one, what is the business need? And that's the first question you should be asking. Where can SharePoint fit into the information management strategy? What is the company's information management strategy? Once you understand that, you can do a really good job of aligning the technology to the information management strategy. And I think that's the biggest mistake from a SharePoint perspective that we make, is we go and roll out the technology before we understand what the actual business need is. The last area is understanding your data silos. There's a lot of different areas of information in your business. And we want to encourage you to be less, I guess, narrow-minded in thinking about, oh, well, I've just got this SharePoint content or this file share content, and I'm going to move that into SharePoint, and then the job's going to be done. We want you to think a little broader than that. Think about what are some of the different areas of content you do have with inside the business, and how will that contribute towards the strategy moving forward? Why SharePoint 2013? Well, a couple of great functionality that they brought to the table. Microsoft, I'm sure you guys have heard, you know, been to a lot of other conferences and heard Microsoft talk about it and other speakers out there. But for the first area is from a business intelligence perspective. A lot of Excel BI and services, Visio searches, performance point services to be had there. From a search perspective, Elaine, what have you seen from a search perspective? What's your opinion on the benefits there?
Yeah, when I start talking to customers, often they want to go to search for all the new, you know, refiners and some of the additional ranking and kind of capabilities there. But then it's quite funny when I show them the previews of documents and how they can, you know, look inside a PowerPoint without downloading and those kind of things, often that becomes one of the biggest drivers, particularly when they've got mobility in mind. You know, downloading a massive Word document or PowerPoint over the internet when it's a slow connection drives you absolutely mad when it's the wrong document. And I think the preview feature really helps with that.
And from a, you know, for those customers, obviously we're talking about online today, but some of the customers out there and guys in the audience, you know, if I'm running SharePoint 2010, one of the great things from my perspective is the ability to have a search farm. I mean, have you seen a lot of that with a lot of customers that you've worked with?
Yeah, that's one of the main things we're doing. I was actually talking to one of the guys at Microsoft before, and we're saying we're not actually seeing that many customers do full 2010 to 2013 upgrades. The most common first step is that hybrid. Which is why, you know, we've got some bits in hybrid later where specifically they're doing search first migrations, just using the new 2013 search features and leaving the rest for a later phase.
Yeah, I think it's a pretty cool feature. I've seen a lot of customers do that as well. And then enterprise content management, some enhanced e-discovery features, obviously team folders. Then social is a big area. I mean, there's community discussions, blogs. I mean, I'm seeing an absolute massive, you know, adoption around social, specifically, obviously, of course, Yammer. Actually, a lot of people using the SharePoint news feeds. What are you seeing out there in that space?
Yeah, again, the same thing, a whole mix. Certainly a lot of people getting very interested in Yammer. That's one of the reasons it's actually driving some of our customers to online instead of on-premises because of the rich Yammer integration and how easy that is. But those are sticking with the SharePoint 2013 on-premises are certainly looking at the new communities feature and rolling that out, often instead of the traditional team sites. So they want to really collaborate and have that more social discussion happening.
And one of the areas I think they've done a better job is in the BYOD space. I mean, I think, you know, every high-level CIO conference I attend, wherever I am in the world, all they talk about is the three big words, big data, social, and BYOD, and it's like you never really see anything coming out of that, and I think they've done a really good job, or better job, on the BYOD space. And I think there's a lot of improvements to come there as well. But obviously classic and contemporary mobile views, automatic redirection and mobile web apps, which is definitely, I think, some good value. And then the app model, I mean, that's awesome, right? Some good changes there.
Yeah, certainly some challenges for developers to get used to the whole new model, but it also gives us a lot of integration where we can quite easily pull in a lot of third-party apps now. It's starting to get a lot more in the app store that you can pull in from an enterprise perspective.
And definitely, you know, from the app model perspective, you know, enhancements on scalability as well. I think that's a big part of it.
Yeah, certainly our IT friends love that they don't have to have all their customizations on the SharePoint server because, you know, as a SharePoint consultant, I spend a lot of my time fixing, you know, installations with bad code. So
and I really,
it should certainly help.
I really want to encourage you guys to try and understand specifically the app model because in talking about migration, that's probably one of the biggest benefits to the way SharePoint is architected today and how it's brought to the table. When you're looking to move to those previous versions, how you architect your applications from a services perspective is really going to enhance the way you're able to migrate. Do you want to add to that as well?
Yeah, well, I guess it's a real change in a lot of the work that we do. You know, if you talk to me 2 years ago about what we were doing in terms of bringing people on with SharePoint 2010, we called it upgrade, and it was always take what you have and upgrade it, then add on some new pieces. But now we're specifically terming things migration because typically we are building new architecture, working out what the new pieces are you're going to use, and often just shifting content from one place to another. Because if you do a true upgrade of everything, things like the app model, you might not take advantage of that piece. You know, and lots of other pieces in there are the same.
So those are some of the high-level features. I think I want to talk about Office 365 specifically and the benefits there. you know, of course, the deployment is a no-brainer. I mean, I think one of the more complex side of the SharePoint side of things is the fact that you know, it's not like Exchange where you say, well, I don't want to own an Exchange server. It's actually easy. Let's move Link and Exchange mail into Office 365 and be done with it. A lot more considerations and thought to be put into that. We'll talk through that as well. But you know, obviously, you know, from a deployment perspective, really easy to be up and running with very, you know, almost no consideration around hardware or anything like that. You know, easy to forecast, so predictable from a cost perspective. Obviously, as techies, we probably don't care as much about that, but I think important to understand that's really, you know, a lot of the kind of high-level executives I talk to are all talking about the fact that Office 365 kind of brings a cost-cutting sort of approach for them, which is a good and a bad thing, but I think definitely there's predictability in the pricing model for customers, which is great. Faster updates, as you know, the you know, we'll talk about that, Elena, in terms of the release cycles are changing.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the case in point, Yammer was on Office 365 and integrated before the white paper was out for on premises, and I think with most of the updates, we, you know, Microsoft's already announced that's what they're going to do. Just like with CRM online, we'll get updates in Office 365 well before they're available for on premises.
What do you think are the positives and negatives for a customer that's you know, sitting in a position where they were used to being in the position where, hey, we have an on-premise server, and now all of a sudden we're getting changes every 90 days. We used to do, you know, service pack upgrades, service pack 1, service pack 2, whatever, and now we're in a position where there's changes happening regularly. What are the considerations that you think there are?
Yeah, it's quite interesting. When I talk to IT people, they often think that the business is going to be really freaked out and quite scared by this. When I talk to the business people, they're typically all for it. You know, people are used to this kind of thing these days. We all get our smartphones with a little update icon. We know things are coming regularly and we want new features. The biggest con I see is for people that are trying to do hybrid, though. What we're often finding is if they've got Office 365 for some functions, it does a lot more stuff than their on-premises environment might be able to do because it hasn't been updated recently. It doesn't have the new features. So it drives you to try to have that as up-to-date as Office 365.
And I think any of these changes are going to have positives and negatives. I mean, I think, you know, Office 365... you know, it's going to force, I think, the end user to learn quicker. I think that's a good thing.
Yep.
You know, you get stuck on whatever version of, you know, SharePoint you're on or Office or whatever you're using, and the changes happen once every 3 or 4 years and you kind of get lazy. I think it's going to encourage that. So obviously integration of Exchange Link Project and Dynamics, some great benefits there. The concerns is a lack of control, you know, the inability to deploy, you know, fully trusted solutions. You know, the update is something you can't opt out of. So you just got to accept that you're going to get updates every 90 days and that's the way it's going to be. The lack of flexibility, you know, SharePoint 2013 only is the version that you're going to get. There's no remote blob storage. I've heard a lot of concern around that. You know, that's kind of up in the air as to whether that should be a concern or not, but people certainly talk about that. And then a big one is regulation, compliance, data sovereignty. Is basically we've got a position where, and we're going to talk about this a little more in detail, is how do you, if you're a company that has a high level of regulations or classification on your data, how do you take Office 365 from a SharePoint perspective and actually decide what content's going to sit in Office 365 and what may sit on-premise? Because we believe there's always going to be a hybrid model. We'll talk about that, but most certainly that's a concern. Data loss, access to data without connection. So yeah, if you don't have connection, you don't have data. So that is a kind of a concern. And I think there's always that little piece in your head where you're thinking, what if Microsoft loses my data? And I know I've heard that from a couple of customers.
Look, I mean, I think the strategy where what if Microsoft loses my data, it does come up a lot, but you know, often then I talk to the company about what their IT practices are and, well, Microsoft, a whole country can go offline and your data will fail over. Do you have that set up? Probably not.
Yeah.
Just saying. The internet connection point, though, is a real cause of concern for some customers, just simply because their internet traffic is either intermittent with a satellite link or it might be quite slow at particular times. And certainly things like SkyDrive can help with that, but it definitely is something that needs to be considered.
And I think, I mean, I personally, you know, don't think it's as much of a concern, because I think there's always going to be that hybrid scenario where you'll have a situation where you will have a bad data link and you're going to have a server, you know, that's kind of sitting there and potentially replicating between the two. So a lot of things to think about there on the concern side. So just from a hybrid perspective, you know, when you're thinking about the cloud, public or private cloud, you know, or on-premise farms, really some considerations to think about is the workloads that you're going to be running, and understanding, you know, what the risk factors are. I'll talk about those as well. And also, you know, there's a gradual transition to the cloud. I mean, let's be honest, it's not just going to be, you know, bang, and we're all moved to the cloud, unless you're a, you know, 5 or 10 person organization. But for even, you know, hundreds to thousands to hundreds of thousands of users, that is something that's certainly not going to be happening overnight. And obviously, I think, you know, one of the concerns is definitely the integration between, you know, Office 365, you know, even, you know, private cloud and on-premise. That's definitely, what are some of the technicalities behind that that you're seeing?
Yeah, one of them's identity. People often, when they do jump onto Office 365, particularly if they're a greenfield or newer customer, they might go with Office 365 online identities. Then that prevents them from trying to integrate with a lot of other things, even if they might have, you know, private cloud with a domain controller, those kind of things. So certainly getting that identity piece set up is pretty critical for doing the hybrid. And then looking at technologies, you know, it is all claims-based authentication. That's great for some of the Microsoft stack. A lot of the older applications just simply don't understand that technology yet to be able to integrate. So there are some extra things you'll have to add on if you want to do the level of integration you might require.
Cool. So I'm just going to dive into it. And guys, we've obviously listed the session as level 300. We're going to get into some very deep technical stuff, but we really want to give you guys a view into how the business is looking at this, because migration, like I say, is not just as simple of moving content from A to B. There's a lot of things that you as IT, even though you're very technical and you understand, you know, how this is going to be done and potentially some of the risks from a technical perspective, we really need you to think about some of the areas that the business is going to be worried about. So let's first look at information assessment. I'm going to look at information dynamics, metadata tagging, and data classification, all areas which I would say, and this is to me probably one of the most important areas of migration, is these 3 points we're going to talk about. So most organizations, and I'm going to give it more from an IT perspective, have the approach of, let's migrate, we'll archive, and we'll delete. So I've got 10 terabytes, and we do have customers with that amount of data. Let's get it all over into the new environment, and we'll worry about it later. Okay, I'm going to talk a little bit about that at the end of this section, but that's essentially what the approach is. So let's look at this from a risk assessment perspective. And I'm saying to you guys, we don't want you to just focus on what you can see, okay? We all know from our own personal data perspective, we know what we own. But the reality is there are so many different areas of content out there that it's very hard to understand what the different levels of risk are. So, you know, of course, from an iceberg perspective, I can see the iceberg. There it is. You know, it's great. That's my risk awareness. But I don't really understand what the underlying risks are. And when I talk about risks, I talk about the data that's sitting underneath the surface, potentially not touched. Maybe dark data sitting in file shares. There's a whole heap of information that I want you to encourage you guys to really dive into and understand. So the first of all, you're looking, like I said, regularly accessed data. And that data is stuff that is probably used within the last, even be extreme and say between the last 6 months and a year. We're going to have, a lot of you have got data sitting out there that's not been touched in 5 years and still sitting in quite vulnerable places. And then there's the unaccessed data, which is the risk ignorance part, is where is this data, in what format is it stored? Is it in file shares? Where, you know, it doesn't necessarily have to be in SharePoint. We definitely want you to understand, you know, the greatest scope of content we're talking about, not just the SharePoint. I'll talk about that in the next slide. And then there's data cleanup. You know, it's not an easy thing to do. It's a long process. It can be quite pricey. And I talked about dark data sitting in file shares where, you know, it's just completely exposed and lack of understanding around what's sitting there, and actually lack of understanding of who owns this content as well. Migrating old data, say it's expensive. It's not a cheap exercise. You guys have probably, if you've been in SharePoint for a number of years, this is probably you going, oh, geez, not another migration. I'm going through this now for the third or fourth time.
It's funny you say that, though. I've got so many customers that are migrating for the third or fourth time, and the data they're migrating hasn't been touched since the first time they migrated it. They're, you know, literally bringing 2003
data. Three times, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And if you look at going to the cloud, you're going to push that through your internet connection. Mm. So it's not only expensive, it's going to be slow as well. And up there, you might be paying for extra storage for it.
And that is one of the concerns. You know, migrating content into Office 365, unfortunately, is, you know, if you're using a third-party solution, you're going to get probably 2 gig a day of transfer. It is very, very slow. So the cleanup process here is absolutely critical, because you need to understand what content am I putting in Office 365, realizing there are constraints around how quickly you can move it. Okay, and that's probably one of the smaller concerns, but absolutely a concern. And then we look at from a metadata tagging perspective. It is absolutely critical to understand that the metadata attached to documents in SharePoint is not necessarily fixated to the document itself. So metadata tagging is important to be doing metadata tagging with inside the document, because if you move the document from A to B, you still maintain those tags, and you're still able to, if you've got some more higher complex security solutions that you're using, there's ways of protecting data based on its metadata tagging with inside the document. And you really need to understand, I said, know your classification requirements. I can't tell you. In fact, I can count on one hand the amount of customers that I've spoken to on a global scale that actually, from an IT perspective, have looked into this. There are absolutely business requirements around the classification of that data and how it's protected and what the exposure areas are. So I really want you to talk to your business and understand what those layers of classification are, and then go back to the drawing board and figure out how are you going to implement this and how you're going to manage this risk. Because in bigger organizations, this can cost a lot of money if there are exposure areas. You want to add to that?
Yeah, well, I guess I'm talking on another session tomorrow that's really going to drill into some of that due to the privacy law changes that are coming. So I think we can probably, if you're interested in that area, definitely worth coming along to see what the privacy law changes are.
Cool. And then information dynamics. Really want you, like I mentioned, a lot of different data silos. You may have documents and Lotus Notes, LiveLink, you know, vignettes, Stellant sitting out there. Not just SharePoint, and there's file shares as well, and exchange public folders and email and all that sort of thing. Really take a large view at that scope and understand, you know, what is that content? What does it look like? What are the document types? What are the sizes and average sizes of those documents? The smallest and largest sizes. The content size count, overall document count, you know, for your entire move. So, you know, is it millions or billions or thousands? How many documents are you migrating? And the reason that you need to understand this information is because when it comes to moving to the cloud, this information is important to understand what sort of speed you can move this data at. Database counts, sites and site collection counts per content database. Really drill down into this information and understand the dynamics of that information. And I would go as far as saying, don't just understand your average size of document, understand the average size per document type as well. You really want to drill into that information and get a good understanding of what that content looks like.
Yeah, so we used to have some really, really good commands for gathering customizations and information about the SharePoint farm. So most common thing we used to do was to run a SDS-ADM pre-upgrade check, and that gave us this nice report of what was on the SharePoint farm. Unfortunately, that doesn't really exist for the farms that we're hitting now. So a lot of what we do is go in and run a whole bunch of PowerShell commands to try to work out what's actually been installed in the farm and have a real deep look in terms of what's been set up if you're doing a migration from an existing SharePoint version. Typically, when I start talking to customers about this, they always tell me, oh, no, I've got no customizations, haven't installed any third-party products. But as soon as you start drilling in and actually having a look around, there's often quite difficult things to remove. And that's why typically we are often doing, as I said earlier, migrations, where we set up an entirely new IA, a new farm, and just pull information across. Because sometimes with a lot of those difficult customizations, that's the easiest way to get them out of your farm. And you may as well do it then rather than bring them across and try to fix them.
And then from a third-party tools perspective, there's obviously, you know, there's some of the, a lot of scripting you can do to get this information, and there are some pre-checkers that you can get from third parties. You can check those out as well.
Yeah, we even run a lot for also usage, again, to kind of find out that scenario around, are you actually using that information? That's one where SharePoint's not the best in terms of some of those analytics.
And scripting is cool, I think, but at the end of the day, do you really want to spend the time, you know, scripting against some of these things when there's some stuff you can, some cool stuff you can, even some free stuff out there you can get as well. So back to the first slide I mentioned, so in how you should think, and is really, let's delete first, and part of that process is once you classify data and you actually do some metadata tagging, you can do some very intelligent things to determine what gets deleted, what gets moved to Office 365, and what gets moved to on-premise or even to a private cloud. So once you do that classification and that tagging, this process is a lot easier. So we can delete, archive, and then migrate. And then you're talking about cutting down probably, I don't know, 50, 60% of the content that you were looking to move, and we find even can be as high as 80 or 90%. So not that that content is irrelevant, but it's not relevant to move into a very highly productive, streamlined system that's going to be used on an ongoing basis.
Yeah, there's also a lot of duplicates often, you know, particularly if you're doing file system, even with SharePoint, there's often a lot of duplicates in there. So a lot of the tool sets do deduplication testing, so you can kind of get rid of a lot of that junk before you bring it across.
Sure. And then from an information management perspective, you know, kind of the previous slide does talk a little bit to this, but, you know, looking at the lifecycle metadata and the permissions of this is all really important stuff to remember from a move perspective. The full fidelity is really important in your move, and you need to make sure you maintain all of that. So we're going to move on to designing a new architecture. And before Elaine jumps into this, I want to just put this in your head, you know, taking into consideration some of the previous things we talked about. Once you understand the dynamics of your information, and that's why that first stage is so critical, not just understanding the dynamics of the information, but doing the classification and actually the metadata tagging, because when it comes to designing your architecture, your considerations for that design are going to be made based on the information you've gathered in the beginning. So you need to go through that process very thoroughly. Starting with the business and understanding their requirements and their needs, and then drilling down further to where you come to a point where you say, right, now we have the content and we can start thinking about the designing the new architecture.
Yeah, absolutely. Certainly the migrations we do where the business is heavily involved are always the most successful ones. If it's just IT-led, focusing on the technology, it doesn't tend to be more than just a platform shift. So absolutely chatting to the business is a good step. So what are some of the things we should consider, really, when we're looking at upgrades? The first is really what kind of upgrade you're doing. You've really got three choices here. You could just be upgrading to the next version. So maybe you're doing SharePoint 2010 and you're going to go to SharePoint 2013. I've still got some customers that are on 2007 and considering 2010. But then your other choice is, if you're on an old platform, why do a single version jump? Why wouldn't you go to the latest? So you might go from 2007 all the way over to 2013. Or, of course, are you going to upgrade and migrate to the cloud? And with each one of those, you've got considerations that you'd want to take into account and have a look at. So if I'm going to upgrade to the next version, really, this is usually the easiest way. This certainly has great out-of-the-box support, and you can do database attach, which we'll talk about down the next section. And typically, this is the sort of thing you can do relatively easily. You do still need to consider all the things we talked about right at the start. So things like your information, do you really want to shift it without adding metadata and adding value? Is it literally a like-for-like you're going to do? Or are you going to look at trying to get some of the additional value-add out of the new features that you want to add onto the top? If you're going to leapfrog to the latest version, there's no way to do a multi-version jump out of the box. So you have two really real choices there. You can either go through a temporary farm, which is common to do if you're going to go from 2007, build the 2010 farm, pull the data through there, and then pull it into 2013. Or your other option is to go with a third-party tool. And certainly if you're going to do that approach of moving all your information around, it's going to take you a long time to script that. That's certainly one where a third-party tool will add a lot of value in terms of reorganisation of information and put it into the right IA. Are you seeing many customers do 2007 to 2013?
Yeah, we're actually seeing a couple do 2000, actually a couple of 2001 and 2003.
Wow, 2001!
Yeah, some customers that have all four versions, and they're going along the process. But I think, you know, even, you know, it certainly makes it a lot easier, you know, specifically from a 365 perspective. And we'll talk about a little later about having potentially a specific farm on-premise before you actually do that move to migrate into, to make that a bit easier. But most certainly, even, you know, customers that have avoided that and have done, you know, database attach, the majority of them I've spoken to have been very unhappy with that and found that hasn't worked well for them.
Yeah, yeah. It's all about moving your information around and making it better, typically, with a migration. Your third option, migrate to the cloud. Again, with this one, there isn't really any out-of-the-box support for picking up SharePoint on-premises information and putting it up into 365. So, again, you've got those two approaches. You can either script it yourself in some kind of automated manner, or look at a third-party toolset to help you with the automation of that. Of course, you do have the third approach, which is have people copy and paste. Typically, if we're talking about a lot of information here.
What information would you lose in that process if you did it that way? Is there anything you'd lose?
Yes, certainly the considerations around that you listed earlier, really around what do you want to do around versioning? What do you want to do around metadata? If you've got any kind of compliance needs, it's often very important that you keep the original author of the document. And a lot of people that script things or use the copy and paste approach are going to lose that information.
Any generic permissions or?
Yeah, it'll basically say whoever copied and pasted it, which might be, you know, an intern you hire for a week,
sure.
is now the author of the document, and it was created at the time it was pasted across into the SharePoint system. Whereas if you script it with the correct approach or use a third-party tool, you can choose to keep the original author as long as that account still exists and set metadata like created date and those kind of things. Of course, sometimes you don't want to do that. The other problem we have, particularly with file system migrations into the cloud, is versioning. And that's because on the file system, the way people version things is often document_v1, document_v2, and you need to merge them together into a single document in the SharePoint world, which can be quite complicated to do manually.
Sure.
So other technical considerations. You need to work out what workloads are currently in use. Right at the front, we talked about some of the workloads that might drive you towards SharePoint 2013. If you were to look at search between SharePoint 2013 and on-premises and in the cloud is relatively equivalent in terms of the feature set the end user is going to see. However, if a big driver for you is that you want to be able to search your file system as well as SharePoint, you're not going to be able to do that with Office 365 unless you go towards a hybrid environment. Again, another one is the BI workload. There is a lot more BI workload being added to Office 365, but it's certainly weaker than on-premises at this point in time. So you really need to look at what are the things, you know, those business drivers we talked about earlier, what's the business case for using the SharePoint platform, and which one of the platforms does it then match? Also the size of the environment. And that's more mainly from timing. You certainly can buy a lot of extra storage up in Office 365 if you need it, but as Garth mentioned earlier, it's typically quite slow to push data through an internet link. So if we're talking about terabytes of information, you are definitely going to have a gradual migration strategy should you wish to go to online.
One of the things that always impresses, I mean, I talked about those metrics that you need to really drill into around your environment. And one of the things that really always impresses me is when I talk to a farm admin, you know, or even a database admin, and they actually know what those details are. It tells me that they really have done their homework and they know what's going on.
Yeah, it's more typical. You see the big shock of, oh, it's a 400 gigabyte database.
Yeah, what's your average file size? And they just don't. Most of them don't know. But there's a couple of guys now and again, and you know, you sit down and they actually know that information, which really says that they're thinking really hard about their approach, which is good.
Also, the other big thing you need to look at is customization. And again, I mentioned that earlier. Don't just, you know, talk to the SharePoint admin and believe nothing's been installed. You really need to look at what levels of customization are actually in your environment. And also, particularly if you're looking to online, what external applications are you using that's going to interconnect with SharePoint?
Can I stop you there? I wanted you to give an example because this is obviously, migration is very project specific, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So. And you know, the App Store is taking off and there are a lot more apps being added to the SharePoint Online App Store.
So my question to you, in the project that you've been on, and this is a very real-world scenario, so I think it's important information, What are some of the examples where that consideration around the customizations were not considered and the effect that it had on the project timeline?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, typically we've been pretty lucky because we actually run a whole exercise with anyone that wants to go to SharePoint Online to kind of make sure it's not the last consideration. But certainly in those initial conversations, I've had several customers very gung-ho to go to SharePoint Online, and I've sort of had to say, no, look, what we're going to have to do first is we're going to have to go to SharePoint 2013 on-premises. And the drivers for that, in two of the latest cases I talked to, one, they had done a lot of customization themselves. And they've done that level of customization through full trust code. So their choices were, if you go to SharePoint Online, you're going to have to rewrite it all to work in the app model. And it's just something which they didn't have the time and the budget to do in the timelines that they wanted. So what we've suggested there is basically look at a stepped approach. And what they're actually doing is they're going to upgrade to SharePoint 2013 and then start rewriting those customizations over time to use the app model and use a hybrid to be able to do that, where their simpler workloads with no customization will go up to online. And the ones that are very, very heavily integrated with that custom code, that'll probably be a year or 2 years before it actually starts moving up to online. So a much more gradual approach. The same, we've got another customer with heavy integration with a third-party document management system. And the cloud Office 365 version of that, not released yet. So they're looking at using Office 365 just for collaboration sites, and they'll keep the document management on-premises until the vendor of that system catches up and has the integration they need.
I think that's where classification will help. You know, if you've got that classification there, when that change is made, to actually change your rules to identify which pieces of classification move to where.
Oh, absolutely. And just from a messaging point of view, to make it very clear to users where they put information. It's really one of the biggest challenges when you look to hybrid. You have to make it easy for the users. If they don't know what sort of information goes where, they're going to be very confused in that kind of environment.
Sure.
Another big aspect of the things you need to think about is your authentication model. When we go to SharePoint 2013 or SharePoint Online, we're talking claims. You can actually do on-premises with classic mode, but that's deprecated, and you're going to lose features like Office Web Apps is not going to work in that mode. So you really do need to look at going towards claims, and typically you will be doing Windows claims. So from a SharePoint point of view, that works really, really well. However, if you've had some lazy coders that have put usernames and passwords and all kinds of connection details hard-coded, they're going to have to update the code to make it work with the new authentication model. Equally, if you've got third-party applications, you're going to have to change the way you integrate with those a little bit to allow it to convert back to classic mode, and then you'll be able to throw Windows accounts across to those. So just one of the things that we really suggest testing, things like workflow, info path forms, any kind of line of business, or business intelligence data. That's typically the places where we see those connection details and information flowing backwards and forwards.
Specifically, workflow is going to be very complex, for sure, in the migration process, and definitely, you know, from a technical consideration perspective, really understand how that migration piece is going to work.
Yeah, actually, workflow is another driver where some of our customers that really want to do heavy line of business integration as part of that workflow, that is one of the areas where some of our customers are choosing to stay on premises for now rather than to go up to Office 365.
Sure.
You've also got to think about what skills you have in your organisation as well, because someone's going to have to manage this environment for you. So, for example, if you've got a whole bunch of SharePoint coders that are part of your organisation, then if they were going to go to Office 365, they are going to have to learn a whole new way of coding to be able to deal with that model. Now, that's something that they should be looking at doing, but it may take a little bit of time for that change to happen. So you need to account for that in terms of your business process. Equally, if you're going to online, some of the IT people might feel quite threatened by that. So you need to kind of have that discussion to make sure that the business is happy with how they're going to manage it. There does seem to be a perception sometimes that when you go up to SharePoint Online, you don't need anyone to manage it, but that's, you know, absolutely incorrect. You're still going to need someone to configure your sites, look after your permissions, and deal with all the questions that business users have. So that's one of the things you really do have to remember. You're not going to be able to throw away the support team just because you go to SharePoint Online.
So from a project management perspective, I think, we're working on some big projects at the moment, and I think you know, it's a really tricky area to get right. I think if you're looking to execute on a very large project, having project management skills is obviously very important. But the real challenge is finding project management skills that have got experience in this area. And I think, you know, we've had some examples where we've worked with a project manager in a business, with a guy who's maybe been in a business for 20 years, and he knows everybody, and typically comes to the table with more of a sort of I'm a business guy slash project manager approach. And I really think it puts the project at risk. So very important to make sure you have real hardcore project managers that are there to execute on the actual project and deliver on those sets of skills.
It's often quite complicated. There's a lot of stakeholders involved in these projects, so you do need people that can bridge that gap and talk both to the technical team but also to the business.
Absolutely.
And often project managers have one of those two skill sets.
Yeah. So, and then obviously support within the organization. We've talked about this, you know, aligning the technology to the business is all about this, is, you know, making sure that there's the great sponsorship from internally. And obviously, this, you know, when we talk about an adequate level of support, we're not talking about technical support. We're talking about potentially financial support and making sure that the project is really scoped out well from a budgetary perspective, but as well as from an execution and management perspective. And for external and internal, and there's skills that will be internal, skills that will be external, you know, and that's across the board, and just making sure that you have the right approach to make your project successful. And then obviously pick a project management approach. I mean, there's a lot of them out there. You guys know probably a lot about that as well, but definitely worth making sure you understand what type of approach, you know, your organization may be more used to working with a more agile approach, whereas other organizations may be different.
And then you need to look at your customization. So typically we've gone through and you will have had a report on, you know, these are all the things that are installed on your farm. It can be very expensive to fix these things sometimes during an upgrade, depending on how they're packaged and who built them. So the first thing we need to look at is, can it be removed? Just like with data, where we talked about, you know, has anyone touched this data for 12 months? Have they touched it for 2 years? The same applies to customizations. Often when we look at a lot of the customizations that have been done on a platform, because of the new features, we can actually delete the customization and replace it with out-of-the-box functionality for a much cheaper cost than we could if we remediated that actual customization. Equally, looking at, will it work with the target environment? Specifically, if you're going to SharePoint Online and you've got, for example, SharePoint 2010 full trust code, it simply isn't going to work up there, so you will have to take that different approach. In one way, that's one of the really good things about moving to online, because it does teach you to think about the out-of-the-box experience and what are some of the changes you can make. Equally, is that customization built by a third-party vendor? Is it a third-party product, or did you build it in-house? We do find, you know, a lot of the good vendors, they have their story really well sorted out. Even when the product was in beta, you could get a lot of these vendors involved and their products were readily available. There are other third-party vendors that still don't have the SharePoint 2013 or their SharePoint Online version available. They're possibly the vendors that you want to reevaluate whether you should be working with them anymore and look at, again, can you replace it out of the box or with a different third-party product?
And specifically considering the iterations that are going to be coming out of the release cycles. I mean, it's now, you know, I can say from our perspective, you know, we're having to revisit the way, you know, it's kind of scary, you know, it's 3 months, right? It's not a long time. So you really have to think about, you know, and that's done, I think, because the customers have demanded that.
Absolutely.
And I think it's put us in a position now where you really have to think about how you're releasing your own product and how, you know, there are, like you said, third-party vendors that are out there that potentially aren't committed to innovation as much as others. You definitely want someone, you don't want to take on a third-party vendor that's going to limit your ability to do your migration and upgrade.
Yeah, absolutely. And the same with in-house. Even if you've got someone in who's a SharePoint consultant or whatever, there's many times that I actually talk to organizations that they don't have the code. And that kind of limits your upgrade experience there. If you don't have the code or don't have anyone that can support that piece of code, again, another really good time to look at, can I replace it with something else that will work easier in my organisation? If you have coders in-house, then it's great. They can support those pieces. But if you don't, you need to have the agreement in place to keep those pieces running.
Just back to the last slide quickly. Sorry. you know, customization governance is also around, you know, like looking at specifically Office 365 is understanding, you know, what sort of level of customization you can actually do on Office 365. So it's going to really determine what you're going to use it for, what you, and how you spread your workloads. You know, you may find that you will be using online, you know, with Office 365 for more your My Sites and your, you know, just plain old data. And you may be using more on-premise stuff for the more customized things, and you may segment those farms. There's a lot of different ways to architect that, but one of the reasons to understand the business need.
Absolutely. Cool. So some of the pre-upgrade considerations. The first thing we need to look at is disruption. So really, people often comment a lot on downtime. They think about how long is my data going to be offline? How long are the servers not going to be available? For an end user, though, disruption is actually often more important, which is basically how's my day-to-day job going to change? You know, if they don't know that when they come in on Monday where their SharePoint site's going to be, can I access it, that's going to be a bigger deal to them. Equally, if features have changed and they haven't been told about it and they're not expecting it, they're going to find this very, very hard to use. So we need to look at not only how long are the servers are going to be offline and what's the technical impact, but how are we disrupting people's workdays? And what's in it for them, really, to use these new features? Then looking at downtime, there's absolutely no way to do this with zero downtime. So we've always got to have the discussion with what level of tolerance can you handle? And typically, the customer will always say, zero, we need it. You know, the business needs every document always automatically available.
Wouldn't you say that the downtime is more specific to, you know, the highly customized areas? I mean,
yeah, it can be, and that really just informs what your upgrade method is going to be. So particularly with something like a gradual migration, and we've been doing a bunch of these, what we've actually been doing is, for example, providing end users with a nice little page that shows them when their site's going to be migrated. So your site's going to be migrated this time, and this is where it's going to end up, and then they can go in and look at what their status is so they know when it's going to be over to that platform. And that really the only downtime that they actually see there is things go read-only while it's migrated. So it's not actually going down and they can't access their information. It's a loss of service. They can't edit that information. However, if you're doing a big upgrade all at once on premises, you may actually have periods where you do take the whole server offline. Just depends on what level of tolerance your business have. Certainly deploying customizations is one that will often at least recycle application pools and cause that downtime. Also looking at performance, there is absolutely nothing worse than spending all this time, typically on a weekend, doing an awesome upgrade, getting everything across to the new platform, and the second users jump on that on Monday morning, things start running slowly. And for an end user, if things are slow, that's equivalent to not working. And they're going to really rapidly lose all the excitement they had in jumping onto that new platform. So you really do need to make sure that you've taken into account what level of performance you need. With SharePoint Online, internet connection is going to be a big deal for you. If you don't have enough bandwidth available there for the load that you're going to generate, you will very rapidly see people having a bad experience. You need to take that into account. Not just looking at how your existing hardware is going, but also what's the impact of all the new stuff I'm turning on. For example, the social features and search, great features in SharePoint 2013. But they do require more hardware than the SharePoint 2010 platform to get them running.
So how many times out of the projects that you've been on have you seen the requirement for new hardware and what have been the main reasons for that?
Oh, absolutely. With SharePoint 2013, you need more RAM. There's no doubt. Even things like your topology. You'll be putting things like the distributed cache server typically on your web front ends. With 2010, we didn't typically have a lot of RAM on our web front ends. They were quite light in that area. But now with 2013, they need significantly more hardware. And to be honest, hardware, though, is relatively cheap for most organisations. Yeah. So if we get that right at the front, people are using the system and they're really happy when it goes live.
And there's obviously way more virtualisation going on than before. Yeah.
And I think, absolutely. Most things are virtualised for all our customers. We do have a few that are doing really heavy high-end search and they're still using physical hardware. But the majority, all virtualized all the way.
And I think the scalability of the new architecture is obviously because you can segment things, gives you the ability to put things on different pieces of hardware, which I think is part of the benefit.
Yeah, the flexibility is a bit of a blessing and a bit of a curse because one of the things that it means is it also can be really hard to predict what your actual performance can be. So that's why it's really critical. If you can get your test environment to have the same setup, or if you can get into production with all your data as a test run before you actually go live to production, you can hit your hardware and know how it's going to perform. But you need to try to make sure that you do that in a way that, that's going to be similar to end users. And we've seen some horrible examples there where people have load tested their environment all as a single user. And of course, that worked perfectly well. They put, you know, 100,000 hits at it, but all as Garth. Whereas day one, all of a sudden we've got, you know, 10,000 different users logging in, very different behavior, and it's hitting different parts of the system than they even expected. So certainly very important.
I think that highlights the need for rigorous testing as well.
Yeah. Yep, absolutely, and also monitoring of that system for when it goes live, because if you can see what's happening, you can fix it, you know, certainly with on-premises.
I think that's probably the one of the bigger areas of weakness even in 365 is the reporting capabilities, and I think
absolutely.
I think that really makes that process very difficult for customers.
Yes, yeah, it's certainly something that we've seen to be a bit of an issue in terms of who's using what, who has access to what. Those kind of things are not very advanced yet in Office 365, and I'm sure that will improve in the future, but certainly for customers, particularly with highly sensitive data, it's an area where we're looking at third-party tools to kind of fix that gap. Another big one, it sounds silly, like often from a technical point of view, people are like, oh, I want to split a site collection because it might be 100 gig and I need to split that out into different site collections. Or, you know, the marketing team comes in and they'll say, you know, I'd really like the intranet to have a different URL. We're going to hold a competition, the business is going to pick the URL and it'll all go in. And that's a great approach, but you need to realise how many things that can break. And it's not really a technical consideration in terms of it won't break most of the code unless you've had some really bad developers in there hard coding everything. What it will break is a lot of the ways business users access information. They might have linked spreadsheets that connect to each other. They've got links from one Word document to another or links from web pages into your system. And so you need to take that into account. Workflow and forms are the other big areas where people hard code URLs a lot. And so whether or not you're moving to online or you're just moving information around on-premises, the impact of those broken URLs can often cause a lot of business user angst because they literally think their documents are gone. Equally, big notification plan. The biggest mistake you can make is start migrating people without telling them. And I don't know if you've have you seen any stories where people have done the technical upgrade and, hey, we're not even going to tell the business users.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's the thing, you know, and I know everyone in the room is in IT in one way or another, you know, us included, and I think we make the mistake of, you know, thinking, and I think this is, you know, another reason why people are moving to the cloud, businesses are moving to the cloud, is because they feel that IT's approach to these types of scenarios is very IT-centric. It's like, it's my server, it's my environment, I'm going to move it, you know, that sort of thing. And I think that's really where IT as a whole, in my opinion, really needs to rethink their attitude and approach to the service that they're offering their internal customers.
Yeah, look, I often find that it's very hard from a technical point of view to have any idea how end users are actually using SharePoint. They're doing all kinds of wonderful things that you'd never even think about.
Yeah.
So unless you're out there and talking to the business and saying, hey, I'm going to migrate your environment, you really won't know about some of the issues. I mean, I actually had one where we were going to take SharePoint down for a weekend to do a migration, set everything to read-only. Turns out another business unit was doing a massive migration of another system and all their documents were stored in SharePoint.
Oh, wow.
So we would have literally taken out their entire migration project by doing that.
Yeah, I think it boils down to, once again, good project management and good change management capabilities as part of the project.
Yep, absolutely. And also that test environment. So we do see a lot of people trying to do the test environment and have it not the same hardware, or they only test with a very, very small subset of data. It's really critical you test with a full set of data, not only so that you know everything's going to migrate okay, but also so you can get those timings down, because that's how you inform the business how long their site's going to take, whether it's to get to online or whether it's to get to on-premises and be upgraded. Also important to know what you are actually testing for. Again, it is very hard to tell how end users are using their sites, so you do really need to talk to them and have the end users involved in those test phases. Make sure they're testing and they actually have a very good perspective on what they're getting and why they're testing things. All right, we're going to jump into how to actually do some of this migration. So we've talked a little bit about this already. First thing you need to know is where are you going and why, and what are the things a platform can do, and what are the things a platform can't do. You don't want to get halfway through and find out that the capabilities of the platform aren't going to match what you need.
And I want to highlight an area that's a very good point. This is not just about SharePoint. Understand that you might be migrating from something like Documentum, LiveLink, whatever. The capabilities of those platforms are also completely different to what SharePoint. Forget SharePoint Online, and that's even different as well. But you need to understand what those differences are, like Elaine is saying, but not just the SharePoint perspective.
Yeah, a very common one is we get a requirement, and it's often we want to be able to view the metadata of a document even when you don't have access to the document. We want to see the document exist through search. And that's not really a concept that SharePoint's ever had, and there's sort of customization ways you can do it, but a lot of the other document management platforms do have that capability. So you have to talk to the business and weigh up how important is that feature. Are they expecting it to be there or not to make it successful? Then it's really about how do I get there. So, as I mentioned earlier, if you're going to online, there isn't really an out-of-the-box way to do this other than getting a whole bunch of people to copy and paste, or someone very experienced to write a whole bunch of scripts, or looking at the third-party tools. Certainly there will be things which will be difficult to migrate with customizations, and some things which are basically impossible. In-running workflows, for example, you're simply not going to be able to pick up your in-running workflow and have it automatically running up on online. So some of these details can be quite fine-grained, which is why we always recommend you need to have a proof of concept or pilot to make sure you're absolutely confident that everything's going to go across. And then it's all about the organisational changes as well. And we've already talked a little bit about this. So making sure that not only do you get there, but you have someone there to support people on day one and you've talked through the organisational change you're causing. As we mentioned earlier, best thing to do is delete as much of your content as you can in terms of your classification scheme as well allows you to do. Get rid of the content you don't need to upgrade. Going to be a lot easier to get across to the migration place that you want to. And then you can look at archiving off the other things that you don't need to bring across. Often you have a quite complex mapping between where information sits and where you want it to sit in the future kind of environment. So often there's quite a complex, whether it's Excel spreadsheet or something you need to put together to communicate that through to the business. Then we do the pilot. Definitely very important the business does the pilot, not the IT people. Looking at, are all the documents there? And typically we have to give the business very specific guidance on what they're going to check, because they will simply go in, look and go, oh yep, I can see documents there, that means my site's migrated across. We need them to actually do things like, if they've got InfoPath forms, submit the forms through, make sure it goes through the workflow. Anything that's business critical, we need them to test. And typically I would also recommend keeping the old content on premises or wherever you're going to keep it, because they will sometimes forget things and not remember till a week after the upgrade's completed.
Just jumping to the throughput side of things, verifying the throughput is really important because, as we look at this project as a whole, when you actually get down to executing this, the throughput that you're going to be able to achieve is going to 100% affect the budget of the project and the length of the project. So you need to understand what that is and do the calculations really well and put a bit of a buffer in there for things to be even a little slower than you expect. You're migrating onto a system that you have no control over.
Absolutely, and even if you're not doing online, it's a very important point. I certainly had one migration where we're doing terabytes of information on premises, and the first time we tried to do the migration, we actually had to call it off. And the reasoning for that was they literally took so long to send the database backups from one data center to another that basically took out our entire window for the upgrade. And so when we did the second approach, we had to actually try a different approach to get that data across, because even on premises, that downtime of moving information around was so significant it couldn't be done in the outage window. Hmm. And then, script as much as you can. You certainly need to automate this. We do see a lot of people trying to do very manual changes. That's great, but you're not going to do this once. You're going to do two or three turns at this, so you really need to make sure it's all scripted or automated in whatever method you're going to do that. And then the final migration. So we do suggest freezing sites and migrating information across. And we'll talk a little bit more about hybrid in a minute as to how some of that works. Often what we'll look at doing is doing an initial migration for testing and then moving deltas across for future migrations.
I mean, side-by-side migration is definitely, I think, in terms of being able to move, you know, over to a new system and make sure the downtime is limited, you know, you can, you know, take a snapshot of what you currently have and actually test on a test version of live and actually practice that and make sure that that's flowing. And then there are mechanisms and ways to have synchronization between your old environment and your new environment and the content you're actually physically migrating. And then the cutover is easy. It's like a switch on and switch off.
Absolutely. If you can do that delta approach, it's a lot smoother migration. Equally, you have to test that. I have had a few people that have tried to do migration, and they're like, oh, the first time we'll do a full, second time we'll do a delta, and they've tested full really, really well, never tested the delta migration, and it will always fail in some unexpected way with the delta. It's a lot more complicated to do deltas than it is to do a full migration. So as you mentioned earlier, one of the common things that we often want to do is a SharePoint 2010 to 2013 hybrid. Most customers I talk to think this is going to be really hard to do. It's actually really easy to do.
Especially if you're doing, I think if you're doing classification and the tagging, you know, splitting your content as to which goes online and which stays on-premise is an easier job.
Yep, certainly, yeah. So this is, if we're looking at why you'd want to do this, just simply all those customizations. Maybe you don't have time to move them across. Maybe you just want a new feature of SharePoint 2013. Typically, it's search. So you're going to leave everything else in 2010, just move search across.
Exactly.
And you can literally just publish the search service back from a SharePoint 2013 farm to a SharePoint 2010 farm.
I often talk to customers that actually, from a licensing perspective, they own 2013 and they're staying on 2010. And I ask them the question, are you upgrading? Oh, no, geez, no, we're not going to go through that. I'm like, well, you know, and they're not even aware of the fact that you can actually do this publishing of services from a SharePoint 2013 farm. And search is a classic example, probably one of the best examples where having that search farm is going to really enhance the experience of 2010. And on top of that, the benefit to that is when it comes to migrating, the migration process from 2010 to 2013 is actually easier.
Yep, absolutely. And so there are a few other services we can do. User profile, manage metadata, BCS, secure store. By far and large, the biggest one we see is search. With managed metadata, you do need to keep in mind you can't publish the content type hub back. It's just the metadata piece. However, what you need to consider is the design considerations. Often people want to go to 2013 because they've seen that new search center and they want all the previews and all that really nice functionality. If you publish services back and that's the only thing you do, you're not going to get any of those new pieces. So that's actually not something that we typically do. I'll talk about how we typically do the kind of the hybrid approach in a minute. The other things you need to think about is the whole time those two server farms are connected, they are almost like what we would call a stretch farm. So you need to have them next to each other in the same data center, really good connectivity, have them in the same domain, all those kind of things. It will security trim across the farm with no troubles, but very much easier if you're in the same domain. And also think of your licensing. And I don't mean SharePoint licensing. That's usually the easy bit. Most customers already own 2013 anyway. Mm. It's actually your third-party products. Again, some of your vendors are really good with this. They'll say, look, even if you've got double the number of servers or extra servers for a period, as long as it's less than 12 months, we'll give you some free licenses while you do that migration. Other vendors are going to charge you for every one of those servers that you put into that farm, even if they're only there for a few months. So you need to talk to your third-party vendors and find out how much it's going to cost you and make sure you count that into your business case. Otherwise, that can be a very nasty thing you find out late in the game. It'll throw the whole project out. Typically, what we do more of is what I call merge farms. So this is where what we'll actually do is through the use of something in front, like your proxy server, we'll actually be publishing different URLs to different platforms. So if you go to intranet.organization.com, you're going to SharePoint 2010. If you go to same URL /search, we're flicking people into the 2013 server with the 2013 look and feel and all the nice new features.
And we've actually done that internally with our intranet. We've had buckets of information sitting in different places, and the complication was, you know, we really don't have the time to move all of it at once. So we're going to move this segment over here into 2013. We're going to build a beautiful front end and give them the look and feel of 2013 and what users like to see. But if I go and click on the sales link on my intranet, it pushes me on the back end to a 2010 farm, which is kind of not as noticeable. So
you're
still giving that experience up front, but you've got this hybrid you know, kind of play in the background.
Yeah, they're really common to do, and as long as it's communicated to users and they understand, they're not going to have a big problem with this, from what I've found. One of the very common patterns to follow is to do search first, then my sites next. They can start using some of those social features, adding on community sites and doing team sites and customised pieces later. But once you've got that set up in place, you can really pick and choose whichever workloads you want and move them over between 2010 and 2013 at any time you like. Very easy to do. You can actually upgrade things like manage metadata by connecting the, doing a database attach for the services piece as well. Pretty much just back up your database, bring it across to 2013, attach it when you do the new manage metadata command, pipe in the database. And then you need to share the farm back to 2010 as well. So particularly with a search scenario, even if you are doing a search center, you still want to share that search service back to your 2010 farm so that the search in this site is using the 2013 engine under the hood as well. So often we'll do those both approaches. We've got some URLs in the end of this slide deck that give you the full step-by-step process for how to share farms and how to upgrade farms. Next one, we'll just really quickly go through this piece because this is probably the most well-documented piece out on the web. How do you upgrade on-premises if you just want to go to SharePoint 2013? So pretty much you just need to look at the prerequisites. You can't do an in-place upgrade like you could with previous versions. You're going to need your new hardware. We always did that anyway. You do have the option, if you really want to, of uninstalling SharePoint from your current farm, taking the whole thing offline and installing SharePoint 2013. You'd be pretty mad to do that.
From your perspective, please don't do it. What is the reason for the ability to in-place upgrade? What's being gone?
Only ever done one in-place upgrade in the 10 years that I've done SharePoint.
And how did that work out?
It was actually okay, and the only reason I did it is because they weren't actually using SharePoint. Like, they were, you know, it was just one of those farms that was sitting there and they never used. They wanted to use the same hardware, couldn't buy hardware, so we upgraded it in place. It was a very small organisation.
Sure.
Every enterprise-scale organisation, we've always bought new hardware for, set up a new farm and done the upgrade that way so that we could test it. So, you know, I really love that they got rid of this feature because it saves a whole conversation I used to have.
Yeah, totally, yeah.
We also need to think about not only SharePoint, but what are the other minimum requirements? If you still, for example, have Office 2007, it is going to limit some of the features on 2013 that you're going to be able to use. So think about Office, think about SharePoint Designer, think about your browser versions. Again, if you're IE6, you will have some challenges in moving across to SharePoint 2013. Now, that also applies for SharePoint Online. If you're on IE6 or an older browser, which some organisations still are, it may be an issue for you that you need to consider before you do the upgrade. Basically, once we get across there, we can do database attach. So there's a big long list of databases you can attach now. Some of them, while you can attach them, they simply don't make sense. Like the sync database for user profile services doesn't really have anything in it you need to bring across. The other one that while you can attach, I typically don't do, is search. You're not going to get the search index, and so much has changed in 2013 in terms of search. I would argue reconfigure search on the platform in the way you want it for 2013, rather than dragging across all the settings by doing a database attach on that particular service. A couple you can't do, you can't get the index and you can't get the configuration database. Also, a lot of really nice improvements that we've got in there that we can look through. So one of those is deferred site collection upgrade. When you do an upgrade to SharePoint 2013 on-premises, all your sites will stay looking and functioning exactly like they did in SharePoint 2010. It can be a bit of shock to people when they first do that upgrade. There isn't really a PowerShell, you know, really easy way to go, hey, upgrade everything now. So a few commands you can run through to do it. By default, what they recommend you do is you actually allow people within the business to click that button and perform those upgrades. And that's a very different approach than most IT organisations take. So typically you'll want to review that, see whether it matches what your business wants to do. And if you are doing deferred site collection upgrades, you'll have the ability to create an evaluation site collection to see what's going to happen when you flick across to 2013, but you need to account for the space while that happens. It will create double the amount of space. There's also a whole bunch of health checks it will do. So it won't let you do that SharePoint 2013 upgrade step in terms of the look and feel and the other underlying functionality if you have issues in your site collection that would render the site to be inoperable once it pushes across. So you need to have a look at those health checks and see what they're going to do. In terms of our page rendering coexistence, this gives us some interesting stuff for what we do when we have customizations on the platform. From a coder point of view, you need to take this into account. If you're doing that gradual, let the business pick and choose when their sites go across to the 2013 object model. Because you're going to have sites sitting there that are going to look at different customizations. And what will actually happen is there's a 14 hive and basically a 15 hive sitting on the server. And depending on which version your site's in, it might look at entirely different DLLs and entirely different customizations. It's actually really good because most of the SharePoint 2010 DLLs are sitting there. So I've seen really good results in custom code just working. Biggest part that won't just work, though, is the level of change pieces, which is search. Simply not going to be able to get search working across there. We've already talked about customization gatherings. Really, the things that you want to look at are anything that's visually impacting. You're going to want to change that 2013 look and feel. You're typically going to have to do all those visual pieces, master pages, CSS, start from new with your 2013 look and feel, add it on top. Equally, some of your third-party tools, they may not install on the new platform. The ones that are going to stop you from upgrading, though, is anything in terms of data structure. If that's not in place when you do the upgrade, it will actually bomb out and stop it from migrating across. And we'll have a look. I talked a little bit earlier about what the command would be if you were upgrading managed metadata service. This is it actually up here. The only difference between creating a new managed metadata service application is the database already exists on the database server and you pipe the name in. That's all the change you have to make. Very, very nice and easy. Just need to make sure you do those pieces first before you database attach your content. So we want to get everything in place, all the services you're going to bring across, your web apps, your managed paths, AAMs, everything else. Do your content last. And there's a whole heap of PowerShell commands for managing this upgrade process. So you can get in, manage the queues of those site collections that are upgrading, put new sites on the queue, all those kind of things to click on through and push the upgrades through of a database or of a farm or of a site collection. Also, make sure you look at your upgrade log failures. I see this a lot where people go in and they look at all the errors and they ignore all the warnings. And then a month later, things just aren't working. And it's always the things that were warnings in those error log files.
Here's a question for you. I mean, what is the difference you've noticed in terms of the information you will get on an upgrade on this version versus previous versions?
Oh, it's really good fidelity, I've got to say. The upgrade information you get out is really good in those log files. In fact, it's almost too verbose. Sometimes people don't want to read it because there's so much information coming out. Yeah, so it's just critical. Look at those warnings. Make sure you get them all fixed up before you go across. My site's a particularly interesting one because if you don't upgrade the My Site host, all the My Sites stay in, you know, what we call 14 mode, the SharePoint 2010 look and feel, and that will prevent you from doing a lot of the new feature sets. Once you flick that across, you can actually then start having new My Sites and have your My Sites upgraded. Again, they get queued. They only get queued when someone accesses their My Site. They won't automatically go through that upgrade process. Also, we look at what you're going to do in terms of new sites. So when you create new sites, you can create 14-mode sites. If you want, you know, some of the sites that have been deprecated, like meeting workspaces, you can actually allow them to still be created if you wish to. And there's PowerShell commands in the notes for how you would turn on that feature and have it still available. Then we look at validating predetermined sites. The biggest mistake I've seen is, you know, didn't look at the CIO's website and it's, you know, not upgraded, or didn't check it on my iPad like the CIO is going to do the first time he logs in. So make sure you know your users and you're looking at all those important sites as they go through. And make sure you create new things as well. Not just did everything come across, but does everything still work? So things like, can you still search? Can you connect through managed metadata? All those bits and pieces. External data is a big one as well that we need to test through. I think we're about out of time, are we?
We've got a couple
2 minutes.
Couple of minutes.
All right, we'll fly through this piece. Really bad news, and it's pretty simple for 2013 and 0365 hybrid. At the moment, it's incredibly hard to do, and it's pretty complicated. A lot of things that aren't quite plumbed up very easily. Now, this is a temporary story. If you look at Exchange and how easy that is to hybrid, I'm sure that SharePoint, there's going to be a lot of work to get this better. But at the moment, a lot of considerations. The only services you can do are search, BCS, and Duet. And pretty much the only one I've ever seen anyone do is search. The other two, nobody's touching.
Sure.
So what that means is if you have SharePoint online in 365 and on premises, you might end up with two My Sites if you want to use all the social features.
Yeah.
And you need to communicate that. If you turn it off on one of the two farms, you're going to lose functionality on whichever one you pick. Really, three ways you can do it. So you can do it from on-premises, can only search Office 365. So that means that if you had customers logging into SharePoint online, they could never get back and look at any of your on-premises information. You can do it the opposite way, so only inbound, or you can do it two-way. Two-way and inbound are the harder ones to set up. So certainly search will do both. If you're going to do two-way, this is what your authentication flow and everything needs to be set up. It's a little bit complicated.
How much time do we have?
Yeah, we're going to talk through every one of these. No, look, it's, there is really good documentation in terms of doing this, so we've got some links through to this. Really easy, SharePoint 2013 farm on-premises is needed. You can't do it if you're going to do SharePoint 2010. So this will often drive your upgrade scenario to get on-premises to 2013 first, and then you can only do it on certain tenants, so E2, E1, E2 or E3. You need to have all that single sign-on set up first, and I'm not going to talk through all those pieces because that's everything in that crazy diagram you saw. Once you've got that configured, the SharePoint piece is incredibly easy to do. And really the things you need to think about is 99% of this setup is happening at Active Directory and your reverse proxy. These are things SharePoint admins don't typically know very much about. So they're not going to do the steps that you're going to need to hybrid and take into account your change control. I've seen a lot of customers that only allow production servers to access the internet, which means you're setting up that whole diagram you saw before straight in production for the first time.
That's crazy. That is crazy, yeah.
It is, and it's very challenging to do that. You can get it through, but it's going to take a lot of change control, and you know, you've got to be very careful about those steps. Once you've got all that set up, though, SharePoint, super easy if you wanted to do search. You basically just go in, remote result source, click on through and set up a result block, and that's it. It's going to connect on through. All those steps in detail are in these links in here. So you can literally go through step by step and get that set up if you want to be able to take that approach.
So, yeah, in summary, you know, first of all, thank you for making time again today. Certainly enjoyable to share with you all. Please feel free to come and chat to us afterwards if you've got any questions. But in summary, number one, determine your business case. Number two, do an assessment of your information and make sure you get it right. Number three, go through the right processes to design your architecture and take the right considerations. Number four, there are a lot of pre-migration considerations to be made and make sure you understand what those are. And finally, perform your migration, and we wish you guys the best of luck. Thank you for your time. Just one reminder, please, can you complete your evaluation form? There are some prizes to be won, but we appreciate you guys' time. Take it easy.